Hello. Still in Corinthians here. Just a quick recap. Paul is coming to the Corinthians and rebuking them in the truth, pointing them to Christ, the riches in Christ, that they are justified, they are believers, that the testimony of Christ was confirmed in them. Again, not trying to shake them and say, oh, you might not be saved because look at your carnality, look at you and all the sin that's going on and the contentions and the strife. No, Paul is beyond the milk of the word and knows that salvation cannot be lost. And he's confirming with other believers, the church of Corinth, that yes, they are justified. The testimony of Christ is confirmed in them and encourages them again after the reminding them of their position in Christ, that they're of their justification in Christ, reminding them, hey, be ye of one mind, be unified in Christ, judge together according to the gospel in Christ, and see what you are doing according to the gospel and not laying hold of Christ and enjoying him and the riches of him. Again, because they were basically, they're carnal Christians, and have not moved on to the meat, which is just enjoyment and satisfaction of Christ, his high priestly ministry, the just shall live by faith, hallelujah. So again, he's telling them, he's confirming them in Christ and saying, hey, stop the nonsense. Not a commandment that if, or a law, hey, if you don't stop the nonsense, you're unsaved. No, not a, if you don't stop the nonsense, God is displeased with you and you're out of fellowship and like God withholds fellowship from you is if you don't do A, B, and C, or if you don't stop this stuff, you're going to burn in the lake of fire, blah, 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 whatever. No, he confirms them in Christ, admonishes them, to put on the new man, to be renewed in the truth in Christ Jesus, and to be settled in the fact that they are justified by faith, and to move on to the meat, and to see the difference between the pig slop that they are in and the riches in Christ and Christ as satisfaction, right? So he says, brethren, I could not speak unto you as unto spiritual, but as unto carnal, even as unto babes in Christ. So he can't really talk to them about the meat of the word because they're carnal and they're not going to understand those things. They're still being tossed around and they are still engaging in contentions and I am of Paul, I am of Cephas, when in fact they are all of Christ and they need to be boasting in Christ. They need to not try to find things to boast in the flesh and have the strife among them. They need to be unified in Christ and have put on Christ by faith, because we have put him on when we have believed the gospel, hallelujah. And Paul says, I have fed you with milk and not with meat, for hitherto ye were not able to bear it, neither yet are ye now able to bear it, right? Because, again, of what they're doing and what they're engaged in. For ye are yet carnal, he is telling them. Ye are carnal, for whereas there is among you envying and strife and divisions, are ye not carnal and walk as men? For while one saith, I am of Paul, and another, I am of Apollos, are ye not carnal? Again, so he's showing that like this boasting in the flesh that, oh no, I'm a disciple of him and I'm a disciple. Oh, I was baptized with him and blah, blah, blah. He's showing them you're carnal because you're trying to find things to boast in. You're trying to find these divisions among you rather than putting on Christ and walking in the Spirit and having fellowship with one another, which is in Christ, by preaching Christ and him crucified and boasting in Christ and having no provision in the flesh and having no confidence in the flesh, because our confidence is in Christ. Our faith stands in the power of God and not in the philosophy of men, right? So rather than boasting in, oh, I'm of Paul and I'm of Apollos and I'm of Cephas, which would make them carnal because they're not boasting in Christ, they can have their confidence in Christ and be like-minded together by faith in Jesus Christ. Who then is, verse 5, who then is Paul and who is Apollos, but ministers by him, by whom ye believed, even as the Lord gave to every man. So he's showing you, who are these men? Like these people in the institutional church, where they go to these pastors and they elevate these pastors above the word of God, because many of these pastors are even unsaved because they have a corrupt God. They have a gospel that is a different Jesus. It's a works justification. It's nonsense. Or accursed gospels where they say that you're perfected by law keeping, you're perfected in the flesh, you've got to set about the law. Yes, justification is your ticket to go to heaven, watered down justification, but now you've got to really get to work. So it's either an accursed gospel that you need to mark and avoid, or it's a false gospel that you need to mark and avoid. And come out of them, come out of those churches, come out of the leaven, come out of the error, come out of the false teaching and the unsound doctrine, which is damaging you, is putting spots and blemishes on your conscience and preventing you hindering you from coming forward by faith in Jesus Christ, being perfected in your conscience by the blood of Jesus Christ, which purges our conscience, hallelujah, and availing yourself to the grace of God by faith. Again, availing yourself to the enjoyment of the high priestly ministry of Christ by faith. That's what the leaven and the unsound doctrine will do, because it damages your conscience. And that removal of the spots and blemishes is these false teachers, this unsound doctrine that needs to be marked and avoided, which is why we call it out, which is why I do a lot of that clown show edification. So we see what people are about. We see what they believe. We judge spiritually. We judge according to the gospel, like I talked about yesterday. We judge all things, yet we ourselves are not judged of men, because we judge these things according to the gospel. We shine the light of the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ. And we see the error that these people are peddling. And then we mark and avoid. And who cares if they judge us? Who cares if they slander us? Because they're at best carnal, full of Galatian error and leaven with an accursed gospel, but at one point believe that Jesus Christ died for their sins, was buried, and rose again on the third day. Hallelujah. The Lord loses none of his. Our salvation is eternal. Hallelujah. Or, excuse me. Again, they believe false gospels. And they're unsaved. You need to come out from that. And who cares if they judge us, right? So who then is Paul and who is Apollos, but ministers by whom ye believed, even as the Lord gave to every man? I have planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. So neither is he that planteth anything, neither he that watereth, but God that giveth the increase. So come out of those churches. These people elevate their pastors, and then you call out their pastors. I have a friend who's in a church that teaches a repent of your sins false gospel. So to me, at best, that's an accursed gospel that you need to mark and avoid. And at worst, it's a false gospel that does not save, because it's a different Jesus. It's works justification. It's a doctrine of demons. And I haven't talked to this person about this yet, because I don't see them very often, so it's not like it affects me. And I would like to bring it up, and I'd like to talk about these things with them, because it's damaging, right? And this person does have legalistic tendencies whenever we're in a group of friends and whatever, and you can see that legalistic tendencies coming out. Like the silent judgment about how people behave and blah, 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 and whatever. So it like their conscience is damaged, and then they're not bringing Christ as life to renew brothers and sisters. They're bringing leaven and making people uncomfortable. And this is what pastors do. This is what people do that are in Galatian error, or again, just have like false doctrines. But they bring death and condemnation, because they're bringing the letter. They're bringing the letter that kills. They're bringing the law. They're bringing the ministration of death and condemnation, and not bringing Christ as life, right? Because we got to lay hold of Christ. Hallelujah. We got to enjoy him, not God. It's not a demand, but we enjoy Christ by faith. We are comforted by God, and then we share those comforts with the body. We don't share the law. We don't share our seven steps to a better leadership with other people. We don't share our seven steps to having a good marriage. No, we share Christ and him crucified, and let the Lord do his thing, right? We minister the one on whom ye believed. We hold forth the truth of life, or the word of life, excuse me. We hold forth the word of life and encourage you to come forward by faith to enjoy him, to whom the one you are betrothed to. So don't elevate these pastors. Don't elevate these people that have these false doctrines that are preaching nothing. Again, most of them, and who I usually talk about, is the false gospels, the doctrines of demons, the ones that have a different Jesus and a completely different gospel, and it's works righteousness for them. They believe that they're saved by works. That's what it boils down to. That's mostly who I talk about. So don't elevate these people, because they have nothing to share. They have nothing to minister. And again, at best, they would be carnal, but you need to avoid that stuff. Come out of that, and who cares if they judge you? I know I've said that 100 times, and I'm talking in circles with this stuff, but I don't care. So we're going to read verse 5 again. When who then is Paul and who is Apollos, but ministers by whom ye believe, even as the Lord gave to every man? Again, trying to touch on this because I keep getting distracted. I've got ADD brain. These people that have these pastors, that they are saved people because, you know, Corinthians, they were a saved people. And these people that are in the institutional church that are saved but are afraid to come out or have this idea that going to church is how you live the life. Going to church is what you're supposed to do as a Christian, even though the pastors preach a false gospel or they preach leaven. So the carnal people, the carnal believers, rather than, oh yeah, but I go to so-and-so on 7th Street, the first charismatic church in all of this area, that's where I go. Even though the church is full of leaven and heresy, these people boast in that. So that's them being carnal. That's them finding something to boast in the flesh. And their confidence is in like these men to lead them to Christ more or less, but, or like to grow them in law keeping, because that's what these pastors teach. So these carnal believers believe that rather than coming out from that. And saying, you know what, honestly, like, this is trash, this is garbage, I don't need the ministration of condemnation and death. Most of them, you've got false gospels, so I don't need that. Repenting of your sins is not how someone is saved. We are all saved. We all have justification by faith. We believe that Jesus Christ died for our sins, was buried, and rose again on the third day for our justification, and we are saved. Hallelujah. And glory to God, because that's how it is. It's all boasting in Christ. There's no boasting in the flesh. So the carnal believers that want to boast in their pastors, I'm of pastor so-and-so, I'm of this so-and-so. Paul is saying, what are you doing? Are you not carnal? Are you walking as mere men? Because you're boasting in these men rather than in Christ. I have planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. So neither is he that planteth anything, neither he that watereth, but God giveth the increase. Again, all boasting goes to God. Hallelujah. God's the only one. So like what we're doing here, the preaching of Christ and Him crucified, we preach. Someone plants, someone waters, but it is only God who gives the increase. And that planting and that watering only happens when Christ comes out through an enjoyment, not a, I want to get rewarded, so I'm going to go preach something. No, you're not going to be preaching anything worthwhile, and most of the time. If you're just going and being like, yeah, I'm going to put God in my debt. I want a reward, so I'm going to go preach. No, man. Because a lot of those people that have that idea of rewards are preaching leaven because they think that rewards are earned through law keeping, which is the bare minimum that you can't do. Or they're earned through, oh, I'm going to go do this thing and God's going to pay me. No, man. So now he that planteth and he that watereth are one. Why? Because we're unified in the body of Christ by faith. And every man shall receive his own reward according to his own labor. For we are laborers together with God. Ye are God's husbandry. Ye are God's building. How awesome is that? We are the building of God. And he is building us up in the full assurance of faith. We are God's husbandry. We are God's building. According to the grace of God, which is given unto me as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation. Again, this vision of the building up of the body of Christ is still given in grace, right? So it's not something you can force yourself to understand. This is the high priestly ministry of Christ. This is the building up of his body. And man, it's deep. It is deep. And I like just the tip of the iceberg, man, in understanding. And it's God that gave the increase. I've listened to people who have planted and who have watered, and it's God gives the increase. I appreciate these brothers and sisters for their gift, for their teaching, for their preaching, for their edifying and encouraging in the body. But it's God who gets all the glory, right? Because he's the one who gives the increase. So according to the grace of God, which is given unto me as a master or as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation and another buildeth thereon. Again, what we've been talking about. But let every man take heed how he buildeth thereon. So he's talking about preaching Christ and Him crucified as the building up of the body of Christ. So take heed how you build. Are you building with wood, hay, and stubble because you're bringing in leaven and you're preaching unsound doctrine and you're preaching demand and burdens on the flesh and not the ministry of reconciliation, of life, of righteousness, of Christ Himself? So take heed how you build, because there's only one way to build, and that's building with Christ by preaching Him and Him crucified. Hallelujah. For other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the foundation, and you got to build with the foundation. Christ comes out, man. It's His fruit. It's His building. It's His work. We just get to partake in grace as an enjoyment, man. This is like, it's not a demand to preach Christ. Man, He does it all. I went through a season the last year where I just like haven't really talked a whole bunch. I haven't really done a lot of videos. It's been a little bit more recently, but for like 6 months, I did almost nothing. And that was also part of a part of a season of the Lord working Himself in me and showing me different things and showing me how like there's no demand. I don't have to be worried. I don't have to fear, again, like punishment. I don't have to fear that He's displeased with me if I'm not making enough videos. No, the ministry of reconciliation, of the preaching of Christ, is still in grace. The building of the body of Christ and how we get to partake in it is still in grace, and there's no demand. It just comes from an enjoyment. And there are times where we have seasons where we don't speak a lot because the Lord is working Himself into us in a hidden way. And our roots are going further and further down and deeper into Christ. And then after that, right? After these, the seasons of really, digging into Christ and Christ carrying us through stuff. We get those seasons where yes, then there is fruit that comes out, but it's Christ Himself. It's not, hey, oh yeah. So When I was going through a lot of stuff the last 6 months or a year, whatever, and I just want to say, this is how I got through it. I read my Bible every day. I went to church. I tithed. I made sure to not hold on to anger before I went to bed, and I made to apologize to every person I flipped off while I was road rage driving. Like, no, it's not that. It's a clinging to Christ. It's a laying hold of Christ and living by faith. It's living Christ. The just shall live by faith. He is impressed into us by the Spirit. The love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. And then that comfort that we have been comforted with comes out as Christ's fruit, and we share it with others. I know I've said that a couple of times, but I just really feel like hammering that down, you know? So again, for other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if any man build upon this foundation, gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, stubble, the two different things that you can build with, or the two categories of things you can build with, every man's work shall be made manifest, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire, and the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is. This is not, oh, you just like these people that we preach Christ and crucified, they don't see that as building with gold, silver, and precious stones. They see it as wood, hay, and stubble. Then they come saying, oh, you just love your sin. You're probably unsaved because you're not doing anything good, blah, blah, blah. What are they doing? They're building with wood, hay, and stubble, and they're trying to tear down the body of Christ. They're trying to come to kill the children of God and accuse God's method of justification and think that they are doing God's service. It's ridiculous. And again, a lot of those people aren't even saved because they don't believe that Christ died for their sins, was buried, and rose again on the third day. But a lot of us who have gone through Galatian error and have been confused at one point or another as the Lord brought us through these things so that we could see them as the backdrop, to me, just like light and dark of like leaven is all old. The law is all the old stuff. We have the newness in Christ now. We preach Christ and Him crucified as life. We hold forth the word of life. That's what we do, right? And using all of that and us, when we were in that Galatian era, we were building with wood, hay, and stubble. Maybe not 100% of it because there was still some Christ that was coming out. But there was still a building of wood, hay, and stubble as we people would come to us and they'd be like, oh man, I don't know what's going on. And then we would be like, well, have you tried reading your Bible? Have you tried going to church? Have you tried just like really trying to forgive people and not be angry? Like, but you're not giving Christ, right? So to me, that's a building with wood, hay, and stubble, because it's not Christ. It's not the incorruptible seed, which is Christ himself. It's not anything of value. So that's what it says when it will be tried by fire, every man's work according to what he built. Did you build with Christ? Did you build on Christ the foundation by preaching him and him crucified? Or did you build with something else, trying to come with the law, trying to come with 11, vain jangling, or seven steps to this and blah, 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 whatever? Did you try these set of activities to purge your conscience? Did you try to stop sinning? Like, no, you're building with wood, hay, and stubble. You're not bringing life. You're bringing death and condemnation by bringing the law and bringing demand and burden. So if any man works, if any man's work abide, which he had built thereon, he shall receive a reward. It's Christ. Christ is our inheritance. Hallelujah. Everything will be burned off except Christ, and Christ will remain, and we will see him as he is. We will be made like him, and we will, hallelujah, shine like Christ shines. Shine with the light of Christ. It is Christ in us. Christ is the one who will glorify us, will give us our sweet glorified bodies. And he's our reward. So don't think that the reward is something apart from Christ. Don't think that it's like, oh, you're going to get a reward and you're going to get a couple Lamborghinis when you're in heaven because you did these certain rewards. And then you're going to actually get, you're going to get your own lake with a boat because you did this other building. No, the reward is Christ. This materialistic view of rewards leads to this materialistic view of building in which you put God in your debt and earn a dollar. And then you have enough heaven bucks and then you can purchase things from the rewards counter, and you can spin the wheel of rewards a number of free times so long as you did these certain number of good deeds, whatever, even though the whole time it was wood, hay, and stubble because it was law and demand. It's just a hilarious idea. If any man's work shall be burned, he shall suffer loss, but he himself shall be saved, yet as by fire. That's a whole different thing. But don't be afraid of that, right? Because what is burned off is not Christ, and what's left is Christ. That's a place of enjoyment. That's a place what's the word that I'm looking for? A place of rejoicing. Thank you. Because Christ is going to be left, and if you understand what the flesh really is, as you grow in the knowledge of Christ and see the contrast between Christ and the flesh, and walking in the Spirit and walking in the flesh, which is not by behavior modification, it's by your mindset on Christ. Again, the just shall live by faith, the just do not live by behavior modification. You'll realize that, like, if you have that understanding as you grow in the knowledge of Christ and see what the flesh is, you'll realize, oh, when the flesh is burned off and everything that was wood, hay, and stubble that I built with is burned off, oh, thank God, because I don't want any of that to stay, because I want Christ alone, you know? So that's the mind of Christ that you start to see things from, according to the gospel, and you're like, oh, this is actually a place of rejoicing because only Christ is going to be left. Hallelujah. Know ye not that ye are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you? If any man defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy, for the temple of God is holy, which temple ye are. I'm not going to go into that right now. Let no man deceive himself. If any man among you seemeth to be wise in the world, let him become a fool that he may be wise. For the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God, for it is written, he taketh the wise in their own craftiness. And again, the Lord knoweth the thoughts of the wise, that they are vain. Therefore, let no man glory in men, for all things are yours, whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas or the world or life or death or things present or things to come, all are yours, and ye are Christ's, and Christ is God's. Yo, how tight is that? Read those last three verses again. Therefore, let no man glory in men, for all things are yours. So again, why are you boasting in Paul? Why are you boasting in Apollos and Cephas? Why are you boasting in your pastor that's only bringing leaven and is carnal at best? Because he's preaching leaven, he's preaching law, he's preaching get to work, he's preaching if you tithe, you'll be blessed in money. If you volunteer your time at the children's ministry, you'll be blessed with rest at home. Like, no, it's all debt wage. It's nonsense. Why are you glorying in these men? Oh, I'm of the First Charismatic Church on 7th Street, and Pastor Pastor John over there is really a spiritual, holy, righteous man, because look at how all these big swelling words that he preaches, and you feel a weight of glory because he's preaching the law, but then you get home and you're exhausted because it's a fading glory. It's death and the ministration of death and condemnation. And he isn't bringing any of value. It's the glory that fades. And then you're exhausted and you need to take a siesta, which siestas are awesome, but it shouldn't be because of a weight of condemnation and stuff. It should be taking a siesta because it's nice to take a siesta. Yeah, anyways, so don't glory in men, man. For all things are yours. All things are already yours in Christ. Why am I going to glory in these men that have nothing to offer me? And at best, they're on the same playing field, because the ground at the foot of the cross is level. These pastors are not higher up the post, not at Jesus' shin. No, we're all at the foot of the cross, every single one of us. It's not a man on a pedestal speaking to 400 or 500 people is better than the other member of the body of Christ. No, we all suffer together. We all rejoice together. We all go through stuff together. We all have gifts for the building up of the body of Christ that we partake in, the planting, the watering, but it is God who gives the increase. All things are yours, whether of Paul or Apollos or Cephas or the world or life or death, man. All things are yours. I know I'm just like reiterating, because I think it's really good to hear this. All things are yours, whether of the world, of life or death, or things present or things to come. All are yours, and ye are Christ's, and Christ is God's. They're ours because we are in Christ, and he is the heir of all things. And we are partakers with him. Hallelujah. We are heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ Jesus. We have been given the spirit. We have been given the spirit of sonship, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. We have been blessed with all spiritual blessings in Christ Jesus. All things are ours because Christ is ours, and he is the head of all things. It is God's will and good pleasure to head up all things in Christ, so that we would be headed up in Christ, so that we would be given eternal life, so that we would be his inheritance, his habitation in the Spirit, so that he can share himself with us freely, hallelujah, and share all things that are of God with us. How amazing is that? Like, that's what God wants to do, is share all things with us, to head up all things in Christ and for Christ to be multiplied. How amazing is that? I think that's so cool. And this is what I talked about yesterday in 1 Corinthians 2, this verse here that I'm going to. Stop it. Go away. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, again, that elevates men among each other, that is full of fear and bondage and this slave mentality, this focus on sin and sin consciousness, even though Christ paid the debt for all sin, so that sin has already been dealt with. So now we should be getting used to the spirit of sonship, the atmosphere of sonship, and the fact that we are heirs of God and co-heirs of Christ Jesus, and that we are the children of God forever, and that all things are ours. So we have not receive the spirit of the world, but the spirit which is of God. And if God be for us, who can be against us? That we might know the things that are freely given to us of God. Hallelujah, man. Amen. That's amazing. Thank you, Lord. This is so cool to me, because like, I just haven't really ever gone through Corinthians myself. I mean, I have, but like, recently, I have not. And ever since I got divorced, I think it's been a year and a half, or it's been over a year. I have really been meditating a lot on the spirituality of a believer, and what that actually means, because it's not commandment keeping. It's just like the freedom to be themselves in Christ, knowing that Christ is the head of all things and that the just shall live by faith. And really not putting on a face for people, not playing the game, standing boldly by faith in Jesus Christ and our justification, and not being carried off as spoil, not being deceived by people who bring in leaven and law. It doesn't matter who they are. If they do it, and they do it for long enough, it can really damage you. as many of us have experienced, and I'm speaking from experience, we gotta like not engage with that. And it's different in marriage. It's a whole thing, but I'm not gonna get into that. You be led by the Lord, look to him, the just shall live by faith. And oh, thank God. But I've been really meditating on that. And a lot of that, like spirituality of the believer and like a lot of, the meat of the word, I feel like comes in nuanced pieces in Corinthians, first Corinthians and second Corinthians. There's just so much there to eat on, to eat and chew on, which is Christ himself. As Paul shares it, and it's same with Hebrews. There's so much in Hebrews about the high priestly ministry of Christ. Just you could chew on Hebrews for years, just like many of us chewed on Romans and Galatians for years. And there's still more there. Why? Because the depth of God is infinite, and his word is part of himself. And there's his word is life. It's Christ. And that is forever newness. So you never finish understanding, you never come to a finished state of wisdom and knowledge in the word, like, oh, I've read Galatians 100 times, I get all of it. I mean, yeah, you could definitely get the large majority of it, but there's still always the possibility of newness and life coming from the word, because it's fresh, because it's Christ himself who is life. He is the newness of life. So anytime you're coming to the word, there's this opportunity to be refreshed by faith, not taking it, not looking at the word as a demand, saying, okay, I've got to get to work and do this. No, it's coming to the word and seeing Christ and being refreshed and renewed in the truth by faith. And again, There's a planting, there's a watering, but it's God who gives the increase. So don't be frustrated if you're not just like full of revelation all the time. Again, I went through a year and a half, this last year and a half of just feeling absolutely beaten. And I mean, for the last several years, just feeling beaten up nonstop. And I was like, yo, what is the point of this? But it caused me to cling to Christ in a way that I may have not done in another way, in another fashion, right? And whatever, man, the Lord's ways are higher and he works out everything for our good. So I'm not like, at least from my perspective, I just try not to look in the past and get mad about it. I'm just like, oh, you know what, Lord, thank you that I'm not there. Thank you that you brought me out of that. Thank you that you impressed a weight of glory. You gave me more of yourself. I gained so much Christ from all of the things that I went through. And now this comfort that I have received that was slowly built up into me during these dry seasons, right? That where there's not a whole lot of talking, there's not a whole lot of preaching or sharing, because I was just in the thick of it. And I mean, still in the thick of it, but now there's a bit of Christ coming out, because, you know, the just shall live by faith. We lay hold of Christ in our trials and our weaknesses. And Christ is our strength, and his strength is made perfect in our weakness. And we start to understand that, wow, the flesh really is crucified. I don't got to put on a face for people. I can stand boldly in Christ. And who friggin' cares what people say about me? Like, honestly, who cares what people say about us, especially if they're false teachers? Like, and they're part of that, the Pharisaical crowd, man, who cares? They're whitewashed tombs and they're still living in their sins and they're full of death and they're still in Adam, because they have not. And the reason why is only because they have not believed that Jesus Christ died for their sins, was buried, and rose again on the third day for our justification. That's the only reason why they're still dead in their sins. So yeah, they can be rude, but they could still receive salvation if they believe the gospel. The grace of God is so amazing. So again, brothers and sisters, like, really been like hammering having confidence in Christ, because it's so important. And there's such a gain from that. It's a gain in Christ. To live is Christ, to die is gain. Die with Christ. Not loving our soul life unto death. I forget where that is, or where I heard that, but and then we gain Christ. And Christ comes out. His fruit comes out. We get to partake in it in his grace. I'm just abiding in the truth, and the truth is abiding in me, just like every one of you, brothers and sisters. And we abide in the vine. We lay hold of the vine. We eat and drink of the vine, which is Christ. And as a branch, which we are, his life comes out of us. All in grace, all in faith, all just out of enjoyment, all from being comforted and now sharing those comforts with the body of Christ so that others would be comforted wherewith the comforts we have been comforted with. How many times can I say comfort in the next 20 words? I think I just said comfort now 8 times. But it's so good. All right, I think that's going to do it for me. I don't really have a plan when I come to these videos. I sort of just come and speak and see what happens. So I pray this message was a blessing to someone out there. I enjoyed it. We got to eat and drink of Christ. And I think it's so important for us to hear about our confidence in Christ, to not elevate men above the word, to suffer the loss, suffer the persecution of these people that might yell at us if we say, you know what, I'm done with this. I'm leaving. This is an accursed gospel. This is a false gospel. I'm gonna mark and avoid. And I'm gonna leave, and I'm gonna gain Christ through this. I know this might be difficult, but I'm gonna gain Christ. And my conscience is gonna be satisfied by the blood of Jesus Christ, and I am gonna grow in the full assurance of faith because Christ is faithful.